This is a levitator. It's not magic, it's not magnets, and it's not being held by a string. The mechanism which allows this object to levitate is all around us. Matter of fact, I can basically guarantee you're experiencing it right now. The force which allows this object to levitate is so simple and basic that is largely unexplored as a serious scientific frontier. But what secrets and possibilities could this largely misunderstood technology unlock for humanity? Well, first, I bet you want to know how this levitation is possible. This object is actually levitating completely as a result of sound. You heard me right, sound. You have probably known that sound has the ability to make you get up and dance, but sound can actually do so much more than that, which we will get to before the end of this video, so stick with me. The process of purchasing and building a levitator is actually a lot more simple in 2023 than you would have thought. For starters, you can go to AliExpress.com and place an order for something called an acoustic levitator. The model I purchased was about $73, although they do have a mini version, which is only like $12, so you could buy that one with little to no setup if you prefer. I got the package about a week later, and it came in a small box wrapped completely in orange tape with no labels or anything. Upon opening this box, I realized that I may have bitten off a lot more than I can chew, because all that came in the box was a bunch of little bags with just electronic parts in a 3D printed white frame. I wasn't sure exactly what I was expecting, but I imagined at least getting some kind of an instruction manual. After some internet surfing, I did manage to find a few helpful videos as well as a complete step-by-step website, which I will leave a link to in the description. They have a nice diagram of how to put the circuit board and all the wires together, which was also extremely helpful, although it was still a little difficult to follow certain steps because the parts were not all the same model, so it took some reasoning to figure out, but I of course have faith in any of my subscribers who wish to try building their own. Overall, I spent around 20 hours building it over the course of 5 days, and to my surprise it actually does work, even when you're like me and have little to no experience building something like this. But what they don't tell you when you buy the levitator is that you will need to have a soldering gun with solder wire and a glue gun in order to actually put it together. Luckily, I was able to borrow one from my grandpa, but I did end up burning my finger while soldering, so my 122 subscribers should be pretty grateful for the dangerous lengths I go to make you guys content. All in all, it is definitely a legitimate levitator. It's not a gimmick or some novelty manipulation, it really does work. You can only levitate pretty light objects around 5 millimeters or so with this model, and they can't be very dense objects either, and that is because of how the levitator actually works. The process of acoustic levitation works by all these little ultrasonic speakers, which actually are car sensors adapted for this purpose. And these little speakers are oriented towards the center in such a way that when they produce ultrasonic sound waves, meaning really high pitch, something called a standing wave is created. A standing wave is what happens when two waves combine and interact in a medium in such a way that the amplitudes of the wave appear to stay in one place, and the nodes, the areas which experience no disturbance, also stay in one place. In the case of sound, as a three-dimensional wave, this means that areas of increased air density, the amplitude, stand in one place, and areas of decreased air density, the nodes, also stand in one place. This way, a sort of vacuum forms between wavelengths, which allow objects smaller than this gap to rest and levitate on these stable equilibriums. And I'm sure you're now probably asking, could sound levitate me? Well, it is scientifically possible. Although, you would most definitely go deaf, and maybe get ripped in half. So, probably not a great idea. For example, just to levitate an object of about 5 millimeters, you need to concentrate 140 decibels of sound. If we could hear this little device, which we can't because it is ultrasonic, it would be very painful, as the threshold of pain is about 130 decibels. So it would take a good amount more than 140 decibels to levitate anything of significant mass. Nonetheless, I wouldn't overlook the possibility of lifting much larger objects using sound. I think it's just a matter of trying to understand the workings and possibilities of this technology. Matter of fact, there is some convincing evidence to believe that these possibilities may have already been realized in the distant past of human history. From the ancient Egyptians to the Maya to the ancient Greek theater and possibly even Stonehenge, many large-scale structures studied through acoustic archaeology have been found to have unique ways to selectively manipulate and amplify certain frequencies of sound. And according to certain texts, artworks, and stories, these structures and civilizations could do much, much more with sound. But we'll get deeper into that in a later video of this four-part series on sound, vibration, and energy. Fast forward to 1866, and one of the first modern-day extraordinary discoveries on sound was made through something called Kunth's tube. I really hope I'm saying that right, YouTube, don't ban me. This experiment by August Kunth used a transparent tube with an adjustable piston to reflect sound on one end and a resonator which played frequency of sound at the other end. The tube was filled with a powder, which, like we saw from the levitator, would collect into the nodal points of the waves. This experiment is mainly used to visually demonstrate longitudinal and standing waves and for measuring the speed of sound, but it also uncovered one of the secret possibilities of the air we breathe. Kunth's tube gave an apparatus that allowed small objects to be held in the nodal points of the standing wave it created. This same principle was applied in 1970 in the Langevin horn, except instead of resonators, something called piezoelectric transducers were put to work. These are actually the same things which are used in the levitator which I showed on this video, but I didn't want to scare people off with the big words too early. A piezoelectric transducer is something that converts electrical energy into another form by using crystals as a means of mechanical conversion. In this case, electrical energy is being converted into sound energy. And interestingly enough, almost all of the time when sound is made, it comes from a previous energy form, whether it be potential, kinetic, or chemical in the case of my voice as I'm speaking. But even though sound dissipates as it travels over time, there are actually ways to reverse this process and actually use sound as an energy force. Sort of like backwards speakers, vibrations in an object can be applied to a transducer which can generate a usable electrical current. So next time you're stuck on a plane with a crying baby, instead of being angry, just remember how generous the baby is for transforming its chemical energy into sound energy for you to harness into electricity. It's just too bad you left your acoustic transducer in the hotel. Hate when that happens. We may not have yet unlocked the deepest secrets and applications of sound, but nonetheless, a great deal of technological progress is being made today on this frontier. For starters, holograms are getting closer to reality than you probably thought was possible. By using acoustic levitation technology, a 2mm bead can be sent moving through space in such a rapid speed that it appears to create a three-dimensional image by shining colored lights in certain areas to reflect the monetary position of the bead as it zips around. But these holograms not only look three-dimensional, they deliver haptic feedback in such a way that you can actually feel their shape. And by vibrating the same bead, it can produce a sound in such a way that these holograms can actually talk. And even greater than that, sound may actually be able to cure cancer. You heard me right. Scientists at the University of Michigan have shown that specific ultrasonic frequencies can be used to target tumors in rats and deplete the mass of a tumor by 50 to 75%. By destroying cancer cells with millimeter accuracy with little to no side effects, this treatment called histotripsy is being investigated for its use in neurological and cardiovascular diseases as well. A new product called the Sound Beamer has recently been developed and can actually deliver sound from a sort of speaker directly into your ears like a headphone, but without wearing any electronic device. The beamer can actually track your position around the room and shoot ultrasonic waves directly at your head in such a way that it feels like the sound is everywhere around you while others nearby will hear nothing. The long list of new sound technologies in development today range from sound force field windshields to military-grade bomb detectors. Sound plays such an integral role in our everyday lives that we largely take it for granted. Matter of fact, imagine what a caveman thought about sound. He probably only understood that sound has something to do with our ears. Beyond that, no real pattern is discernible for which objects make what types of sound and which don't, unless you start thinking in terms of vibration and energy. By thinking in this way, we may be able to peel back one more mysterious layer of this grand cosmos we live in. So help us peel back this layer by remembering to watch the rest of this four-part series, and don't forget to like, subscribe, comment, and share. Also, check out my channel for more interesting and informing videos on a variety of intellectual topics. And as always, never stop questioning, talking, and thinking. Thank you.